not get what we deserve.
Amen.
I am thankful this morning that I don't get what I deserve. So I'm going to read Psalm 89 because I think David was thankful that he didn't get what he deserved. Yes. Amen. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth, I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. For I have said, mercy shall be built up forever. Your faithfulness you shall establish in the very heavens. I have made a covenant with my chosen. I have sworn to my servant David, your seed I will establish forever. Build up your throne to all generations. Hallelujah. We are so thankful this morning, Lord. Thankful for your mercies. You are good to us, Lord. Your mercy endures forever. We just bless you in this house. Come on, tell the Lord what you're thankful for. Oh, God, I'm so thankful that I don't get what I deserve. I'm so thankful that you see me as righteous because you see me through the eyes of Jesus. I'm so thankful for your blood, Lord God. I'm so thankful for your name, Jesus. I'm so thankful for your Holy Spirit. Oh, we bless you this morning, God. You are good. Your mercy endures forever. Hallelujah. We plead the blood of Jesus over our service, over our children, over our pastor and his wife today. God, lead us and guide us where you want us to go. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth, right here, as it is in heaven. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah.
Never gonna stop singing.
your grace advances. Let it burn up the night. Let it burn up the night. Let the walls come down in Jesus' name. Let the lost be found in Jesus' name. Let the church arise to shine your light to the world. Shine your light.
Your house forever undivided.
All your sons and daughters one. At the cross we are united. Our hope is in the blood. Our hope is in your blood. And the walls come down in Jesus' name. Let the lost be found in Jesus' name. Let the church arise to shine your light to the world. Shine your light. Open eyes to see in Jesus' name. Let this city sing in Jesus' name. Let the church arise to shine your light to the world.
Let the walls
shine your light. Jesus' name, let the church arise to shine your light to the world. Shine your light. Open eyes to see in Jesus' name. Let this city sing in Jesus' name. Let the church arise to shine your light to the world. Shine your light. Your face, your life forever flowing to wash our sin and shame away. Salvation's tide is rising as all your people seek your face, your life forever flowing to wash our sin shame away. Salvation's tide is rising as all your people seek your face, your life a river flowing to wash our sin and shame away. Let the walls come down in Jesus' name. Let the lost be found in Jesus' name. Church arise to shine your light to the world. Shine your light. Open eyes to see in Jesus' name. Let the city sing in Jesus' name. Let the church arise to shine your light to the world. Shine your light.
Let the walls come down in Jesus' name. Let the lost be found in Jesus' name. Let the church arise to shine your light to the world. Shine your light. Open eyes to see in Jesus' name. Let the city sing in Jesus' name. Let the church arise to shine your light to the world. Shine your light.
How many's ready to let their light shine? Come on, how many's ready to let their light shine?
Amen.
How many knows it's important to let our light shine, especially in these last days?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Before we take up our offering today, Sister Angel, Sister Carolyn, her and her husband pastor in Lake City. Last year about this time, she had open heart surgery, and God brought her out of that, and to this point, she went in the hospital. I'm assuming it was Saturday or Friday night. her hemoglobin, which is your blood, was like below 6. They would not let her leave the hospital. So they gave her 2 units of blood overnight, and it brought it back up. And yesterday, she's seen, now this is, you know, kind of unheard of. They were worried about her blood level. They had all kinds of specialists come in and did all kinds of blood work. And long story short, Angel talked to her again this morning. Her blood level has dropped again. And the doctors are coming to the conclusion that she could have leukemia. I rebuke that in the name of Jesus. Because she's a servant of the Most High God. She has served God for many years, and she's been a pastor's wife for many years. She's helped people more than I could ever help in my whole lifetime. So there, she's facing this unknown today. So this is what I want us to do. Sister Angel, I want you to, honey, I want you to come. I want you to stand in front. We're going to pray for Sister Lee, Carolyn, as we know her. I call her Sis. But this is Sister Angel's sister, her second mom, if you will. Because when Angel was born, Sister Lee, or Sis, was 18 years old when Angel was born. So she's like a second mom to Angel. And she's actually acted like a second mom to Angel. But I want you, if you believe that God can and God is and God will, I want you to come and I want you to join around her. We're going to lay hands on her. We're going to anoint her on her sister's behalf. Because this is a battle. That's all it is. It's a battle. But battles are won by prayer. We're going to pray. We're going to pray for a complete healing. We're going to pray for whatever this condition, whatever's going on, we're going to pray that God is going to clear it up today. And how many believe that today? Let us pray.
did that, won't you give God a big shout of praise in this house? Come on, you can do better than that. Do you believe God did it? Give God praise in this house.
See you.
Church, let's worship for just a few moments. How many came today to worship God? How many who's come in to press into the very presence of where he's at? Let's push aside everything that this week had to offer. Let's not worry about what's coming up ahead of us. Let's get into the very presence of God Almighty.
We have come to give you.
welcome in this place. You're welcome in this place. You're welcome in this place.
Come to let God have his way this morning. come into this house, we give you praise. We come into this house because this is where you dwell. We come into this house, Father, to see you move upon your people. God, we welcome you in this place to have your way, to bring healing, to bring deliverance, to bring refreshing, to bring renewal. In the name of Jesus, we thank you today for what you have come to do. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. We bless the Lord with all that is within me. We bless your holy name, God. Have your way. Have your way, Lord, in us today. Give God a shout of praise in this house. Hallelujah. If God's blessed you this week, give God the biggest praise that you can offer him this morning. Hallelujah. You may be seated for just a few moments. Sister Angel's taking the little kids out. Welcome to October 1st. All I have to ask is one simple question is, where did the rest of the year go? It seems like we started in January and jumped all through right. I don't know about you. It just don't seem right to me. Amen? Today we're going to be starting a new series called Make Your Move. And how many knows that sometimes we move in certain directions? And how many in here has ever moved from one place to the next? How many has ever played chess? Anybody play chess? How many knows that there's a lot of strategy and a lot of moves that you have to make on that chessboard? And all of us have made a move at one time or another, but today we want to make a move. We want to move from where we were to where God wants us to be. Amen? We want to move from lack to blessing. Come on, somebody. Does anybody not want to be that way this morning? Does nobody want to move from lack to blessing? I don't know about you, but I want God's blessing on my life. I don't know about you. So the first part of this message today, the first series of this, the first sermon of this series, is let God's Spirit move in. And how many knows we need to let God's Spirit move in on us? Not only move in on us, but move in us and through us. Amen. If you got your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We're going to skip over to chapter 3 in just a few moments, but chapter 2, verses 14 through 16, would you please stand for the reading of God's Word? 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 14 through 16. You have it, just say amen. And it says this: but the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. Verse 15: but he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is not judged by anyone. For who has known the mind of God, of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. Go to chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. And it simply says this: brothers, Paul's writing this to Corinth, brothers, I could not speak to you as to spiritual men, but as to worldly. Even as babes in Christ, I have fed you with milk and not with solid food. For this day, you were not able to endure it, nor are you able now. For you are still worldly. Since there is envy, strife, and division among you, you are not worldly, and behaving as mere men. Let us pray. Father, we just thank you today for your word. We thank you, God, that you have blessed us with your word. We thank you, Lord, that we still are able to read your word. We thank you, God, that we're able to still have your word. And Father, we just ask you right now, God, that you would touch us today, God, as your servant. Lord, I just ask you, Lord, to touch me from the top of my head, God, to the very soles of my feet. Let nothing come past my lips that is not to you. And God, I want to give you all glory, honor, and praise for all things in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen and amen. You may be seated. If somebody were to ask you today what you felt was the most important church statistic, that one statistic that would dominate the local congregation, what would that say to them? What would you say to them? What would it be? Possibly, most of us would probably say attendance or membership. That would be a sign of a healthy church. But that, can I tell you that this morning, but that's not what a healthy church is. Amen? Now, if a church may run 500 members, but only 200 of them attend almost every Sunday, and maybe only 50 or so of them may be involved in ministry. So that's not really a healthy church. Even though they have a lot of people, but they have a few workers, that's almost 10% of the congregation working in the ministry of the church. Amen? That's not a healthy church. Amen? So here's the secret. The greatest of churches is the greatness of the church is how many people we find out their gifts and they use them in the church for the glory of God. See, the church is healthy is when everybody in the church knows their spiritual gift that God has placed in them. And once everybody knows that spiritual gift and they're working in that gift in the local body, that is only when the church is healthy. Can I get an amen? See, everybody realizes they have a gift and they utilize those gifts for the glory of God. If we realize that we're using those gifts, then we can be a healthy church. So this series we're going to start this morning is called Make Your Move. And I want you to notice that the chess pieces that I showed up earlier, it's very important to understand those moves. Amen? How many's ever played chess? One or two, three, four? How many knows that it takes a lot of strategy and a lot of planning to play chess? I don't know about you, but I'm a checkers man myself. I'd rather play checkers than play chess because I don't understand this moves that way and this moves this way. I just don't get it. But see, the game of chess is here's the thing about the game of chess, and I had to highlight this so we can understand it. See, but the greatest thing about the game of chess is when the pieces don't even have power per se, like the king or the queen or the knight, you can still have a major impact on the game by a piece that has less power. Am I right? So even the pieces that, like the pawn, the pieces that seem to be the weakest can still make or break the success of the player. See, it doesn't matter what your status is or which status you portray on the game, the smallest, even the minute person, the weakest player, the weakest pawn, it still has the power to break and make the game. See, we as Christians, we have whether we're great in the Lord or we're small in the Lord, we still have power to either make or break ourselves. So, in other words, we need to understand that for God to use us, we need to be a pawn in God's chess game. And quit trying to be a king and queen or a knight in the game when God says, no, that's not what I called you to be. See, too many people are walking in a calling that they were not meant to walk in. Oh, come on, somebody. See, too many people are walking in the position of a pastor or a minister when they're good, no good and well, they're not qualified to be so, but they're qualified to be a teacher, but not qualified to hand behind the pulpit. I've seen too many people who have been mom and daddy called instead of God called. Amen? And that's one of the things that when I had to go through my licensing process, they said, how did you know your calling? How did you know you were called into the ministry? I said, the only way I can tell you is I had a burden and I had message after message after message after message from God to say, I have called you. I don't know how much plainer that could be. He didn't call me to go around. Listen, I'll do whatever God tells me to. If he told me, Bray, you're done pastoring, I want you to go back. I want you to do work with youth or kids. Guess what Ray's going to do? Ray's going to do exactly what God called him to do. Come on, somebody. See, I want us to talk this morning about God's Spirit moving in us. See, John MacArthur, I don't know if anybody knows him or not, but he's a great pastor and an author. He gave a quote, and I want you to read this. Listen to this. He said, no local congregation will be what it should be, what Jesus prayed for it to be, what the Holy Spirit has gifted and empowered it to be, until it understands spiritual gifts. Did you hear what I said? John MacArthur plainly said it. A congregation is never going to be what it's called to be, and it's never going to be doing what it's gifted to be unless we realize that all of us in this room, all of us in the church body, have a gift that God has given us for the gifting and the moving and the working of the ministry of God. Now that's a great quote. I think everybody would agree to that. Well, I'd like to add one more thing and one more thought to that. Not only when the church understands spiritual gifts, but when the church utilizes their spiritual gifts. It's one thing to know your spiritual gift. It's another thing to operate in that gift. See, a lot of us have, some people, not a lot, not in this room, but some people know their spiritual gift and they know where they're supposed to be and what they're supposed to be doing, but they're just not doing it. So do you think that's a healthy church? Absolutely not. Why is that? Because a healthy church has to have everything. Listen, let me ask you a question. How many drives a car? Most of us in this room. And how many knows that if one or two pistons in the engine is not working, the car is not fully working right? Come on, somebody. And if the timing chain gets knocked off timing, guess what happens? The car is not going to run right. Come on. And if your transmission goes out, you're not going anywhere. Too many people in the church world have got out of timing with God. Or they're not working off all four cylinders, or all six cylinders, or all eight cylinders that God has placed inside you. I'm talking to somebody this morning. Listen, we all need to understand that all of us in the body of Christ have a position and a calling that God has placed on us to do the work of ministry. Come on, somebody. See, I think we have a pretty good understanding of our spiritual gifts in our church. I think we all have that understanding. We all know where we're supposed to be. But are we utilizing the gifts that God has placed in us? Amen? So let's talk about letting God's Spirit move in. In 1 Corinthians 2 and 3, Paul talks about three different types of people. Again, let's talk about three types of people. Remember that a couple weeks ago we talked about thrilled, killed, chilled, and what was it? Filled. Chilled, thrilled, and filled. Now that we're talking about three more types of people. How many know there's all types of people in the church? Let's talk about them this morning. Where do we fit? Paul asked the question, are you not acting like mere men? In other words, Apostle Paul is looking to say this, but he looks at the church and says, are we working like we're supposed to be working, or we're just coming and doing the emotions and just what we're supposed to do? That's what he's actually trying to say. Are we acting like mere men and women? Are we just acting like everybody else acts? Or are we acting like Christ acts? Are we walking in the fullness of God? Are we walking like Jesus wants us to walk? Are we just walking like everybody else walking, and we're talking like everybody else is talking, and we dress like everybody else is dressing? Where are we at? Where are you at in God? Crickets. But what's the difference? So if we're acting like pure men, so what are the difference between us and the world? Come on, somebody. What is the difference between you and the rest of the world? Are you dressing? Are you talking? Are you acting like Jesus? Now, I'm not talking about walking with sandals on and a robe and a beard down to your chest and hair down your back. That's not what I'm talking about, because we don't know what Jesus looked like. Amen? But what I'm asking you this morning is, are you walking like Jesus walked? Are you talking like Jesus talked? Are you calling the deaf to hear? Are you calling blinded eyes to open? Are you laying hands on those and they recover? Come on, somebody. So if we're going to act like Jesus, if we're going to talk like Jesus, don't you think we need to start acting like him, talking like him, moving like him? How can we do that? Is when the Spirit moves in and moves through us. Amen? So let's work to let God's Spirit work in us. See, you see, a church is facing a critical problem today. What's that? Well, can I tell you this morning that I hate to say this, but there was an article that I read that the United Methodist Church has ordained its first female lesbian bishop. Openly lesbian bishop. She gets up behind the pulpit and says that Jesus was a bigot, that Jesus was a racist, and all of these things, and we're making him to be an idol when we shouldn't be. Now let me just tell you this: if I could have went through that article and choked that woman, I probably would have, because there's no scripture, and I don't know where she's getting her information from, except from the enemy itself. But let me just tell you this. The Bible says in the last days, beware of false prophets. They're rising up, church. And many will be deceived and fall away. So you better know what your word says. You better have the word hitting in your heart this morning. Amen? So are we acting like the world, or are we being different from the world? He's called us to be a peculiar people, don't you think? See, in most congregations, there's no difference between mere men and godly people. Come on, somebody. I heard a story one Sunday, a person had a heart attack. So the ushers called the paramedics, and the paramedics came in, and while they were doing the thing, the pastor was up there just droning down and on and on about what, you know, his sermon, and totally oblivious of what was happening. One of the ushers heard the paramedics say, as they were carrying the man out, "We had to pick up 6 people before we found the right one." Now, that may seem a little bit funny, but can I tell you, there's a lot of people in the church that are acting like dead people. There's no excitement in the things of God anymore. There's nothing to I'm not saying our church is that way. I'm saying the body of Christ in general. Nobody has excitement for the things of God. I remember as a young boy, and you guys are going to get tired of hearing me say this type of thing, but I remember as a young boy, people would come into church and they would be excited about being there. They would shout, and they would clap, and they would praise God, and they would have their hands lifted. But we have come into a day and age today where if we raise your hand, people think you're crazy. That we're afraid to show our praise to God. That we're afraid somebody's going to judge us accordingly. Can I tell you this morning? Get over it. That's just pride. And Bible says that pride comes before a fall. Amen? As I said, I think I told you guys about Sister Gillenwater last week, where she had that bun on top of her head. When the Lord hit her, that those bobby pins flew out, because she got under the power of God, and she didn't care about what her hair looked like. Come on, somebody. We need to quit worrying about what we're going to look like when we start praising God. It may look silly to some, but can I tell you, to God, it's amazing. It's beautiful. He's waiting for expression. The Bible says that David was so excited that the Ark of the Covenant was coming back into the right place. The Bible says he danced before the Ark, and he danced with all his might, that he danced so much and so long and so hard that his clothes fell off. Do you think and this was the king of Israel, do you think he cared that he danced before the people? Do you think he cared if his clothes fell off? No. I don't advise anybody to do that. Unless it's in the spirit. And if you're in the spirit and everybody else is in the spirit, nobody's going to pay attention. Come on. But he was so excited about the presence of God coming back to the house that he showed with everything that was in him his excitement and his joy and his enthusiasm about God. What has happened to the church world today. That we can't come into the house of God and worship freely and express our worship to Him without being criticized. Amen? I want you to, here are some statistics of members of mainline churches in the past 20 years. Okay? Listen to this. 50% of members are not concerned, are not certain of their salvation. 50%. That is scary. 60% of members seldom attend church. 70% of members give less than 1% to their church. 80% of members have no ministry within the congregation. What do you mean, Pastor? What do you mean ministry? Youth ministry, children's ministry, usher ministry, greeter ministry, whatever. That's ministries within the church. 80% have no ministries within our church. They just come in, preach, and they go home. Nothing else. That's it. That's pretty sad. 80% of members do not attend Sunday school or small groups. 90 have never been discipled or trained. 90%. That means only 10% have been. Listen to this. You want something to knock your socks off? Listen to this. 3,500 to 4,000 churches close each year. That's 10 churches a day that close the doors. I don't know about you, but that is a sad statistic. Here we are trying to keep the doors open and keep people coming and keep people enthusiastic about God, but there's 10 churches a day closing because people have lost the desire for God. They have lost the desire to serve the community. They've lost the desire to do anything to give glory to God. In the 1900s, there were 27 churches for every 10,000 people in America. Today, there's only 12. But can I tell you, in the Church of God, we're planting churches just about every day. We're planting churches every day. I haven't seen the last statistics, but in the Church of God alone, at the last count I had, we had 43 churches plants within the past 2 or 3 months. That is amazing. That should be something we should be giving God praise for. Amen? See, the average size of all churches in America are only 75 people. That's 85% of those having plateaued or membership or declined. 75 people. Now, I don't know where they got that statistic, because one of our churches in Tampa is running at least 2,000 to 3,000 people on a given Sunday. They had 3 services a day. As a matter of fact, one's going on right now. Praise God for that. Amen? So, what's the problem? Well, there's several problems. But I think the one that looms larger over most others is that what Paul was talking about to the church of Corinth. But things haven't changed in 2,000 years. We're still walking like mere men. We as Christians are living beneath our privilege. Can I tell you, just because you're saved doesn't mean that's the only thing you have to worry about. There's much more to God than just being saved. There is, how many of you like chocolate cake with some nice thick chocolate icing and a glass of milk? I know, I'm with you. I wish I had some right now. And I'm not talking about just a thin layer of chocolate. I'm talking about an inch thick chocolate icing on top, in the middle, and all around. Can I get amen? Let's look at that chocolate piece of cake, that whole cake right now, okay? If I cut a section of that cake out, a nice little piece, and say, this is yours. Well, this whole cake is yours, but I only give you 10%. If you only say, well, I just only want part of that cake, just to give me a wedge of that cake. But you can have the whole cake. Would you just settle for the little bit? Would you just settle for that one little slice and say, I'm good, thank you. I know. You'll be pushing that piece aside and say, give me that cake. I want it all. I want to put my face in it. You know what I'm saying? Get it all up in your face. Chocolate eyebrows, chocolate nose, all that stuff. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Y'all just dig in there like y'all Porky the Pig. Nom, nom, nom. You wouldn't settle for just one slice, but you would, and when you could have the whole cake. Now, would you? Why would we settle for just one part of God when God says, I'm more than just all of that little bitty piece. I've got more things planned for you, but you're just settling for this. Come on, somebody. Quit settling for the small part of God and engulf the all of God. Amen. We need to quit worrying about the small. I'm saved, and I'm glad that I am. You know, that's great. That's wonderful. I'm glad you're saved. But don't just stay there. Get all in God, because He wants to get all up in you. Amen. Listen. Remember, Jesus said in John 10. Listen, this is one of my favorite verses of all times. I have come that you might have life. And in the middle of that sentence, there's a comma, and have it more abundantly. I have come that you may have life, comma, comma. You know that little thing? Comma. And have it more abundantly. I've got to ask you this question this morning. Does that even apply to you today? Listen, I don't know about you. See, there's much more than just having life. Living life going, this is so great. This is a wonderful. Jesus saved me. Thank you, God. But see, there, God says, I've come to give you life and more abundantly. You mean there's more than just living? Absolutely. Goes right back to that chocolate cake. Why would you just settle for a slice when you could have the whole thing? Life? Abundant life. The whole cake. Come on, somebody. Are you living or are you really living? Are you and I walking like mere men, or as people that have been endured with power and equipped to the work of the ministries? That's the question. Are we walking like mere men, or are we walking according to the fullness of God? Remember, I mentioned earlier the three kinds of people, right? So let's look at the first one. The natural person, the non-Christian. Look at verse 14. It says, man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. And he cannot understand them because they are spiritually discerned. See, they don't appreciate spiritual things. The natural man they don't appreciate it. See, the natural person has no appreciation for spiritual things. They do not accept spiritual teachings. They don't even embrace the Bible's message or claim it for themselves. Amen? Let's look at the second one. The spiritual person. Look at verses 15 and 16, 1 Corinthians. The spiritual man makes judgment about all things, but he himself is not subject to any man's judgment. For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. See, the spiritual person understands and discerns what God is doing. Amen? The word judgment in verse 16 literally means has the ability to evaluate the things of God. Not judging like, look at her, she ain't supposed to be dressing like all that. According, you know, that's judging. That's not what Paul was talking about there. He was talking about a different type of judging. When you're around others, do other people express their desires for God? Amen? Do you have a sense of spiritual power within your life, your own life? Do you let God's Spirit move in you? Are you walking the higher road in the world, or are you walking along with everybody else? Let's look at the third one, the carnal person. The carnal person in chapter 3, verses 1 through 3, says this, Brothers, I do not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I give you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, and you are not worldly, are you not acting like mere men? This is what Paul was trying to say. See, carnality can be defined as allowing oneself to be controlled by the human nature instead of letting the Spirit of God guide us. See, Paul tells the church of Corinth that there are some of them who are infants in Christ. They're spiritual babies. Amen? Now, wouldn't that be awful? Then let me just say this. How many have ever been to a maternity ward? Well, if you've had a child, you've been to a maternity ward. Amen? So there's so much joy and excitement in that place because they're babies here. Everybody's excited because they have the potential of their baby. They can't wait to see the baby. And Sister Denai is going to have her little bundle of joy in the next several months. And she's going to be part of that maternity ward. She's going to be excited about that baby. Everybody's going to be excited about that baby. I know Brother Roger's going to be excited about that baby. Amen? We're all going to be excited about this baby. Amen? But wouldn't it be awful if that baby might grow up to be a doctor or a missionary or a president? There's so much potential of that baby. And there's hope. There's a lot of hope that dreams in the maternity ward that day. Amen? But I'm going to tell you something that wouldn't be near as much excitement and joy in the maternity ward if that mother was told that that baby is going to be nursing as a baby for the next 20 years. I can hear all the mothers now going, hold up, wait a minute. Say what? He's going to be doing what? I don't think so. You know what I'm saying? For the next 20 years, I don't think so. That ain't happening. But isn't it just, let me go on, that you had to change the diapers for a few months? That's good, right? But what if you had to change the diapers for the rest of his life? Thank God that our kids grow up. Amen? So, why don't Christians grow up? Why don't Christians decide to just grow up? You know, too many people in the church world, they want to come to church and they want to suck on the milk and eat all the soft food, but they don't want have nothing to do with the meat of God's word. They don't want to upset their apple cart. They don't want to upset their lifestyle. Amen. They just want to get by just enough to say, I'm saved and I'm glad that I am. That's all I want. I want to make it to heaven. Can I tell you? There's much more to that. Growing up recalls. See, you know the reason why a lot of Christians don't grow up? Because they're afraid of the responsibility that God wants to put on them. They don't want to do the ministry. They just want to come into church and they want to sit there and do nothing. And that's fine. If God's not called you to do anything, then you come to church. But let me just tell you this. God has not called all of us to salvation just to sit by and let somebody else do the work. He's called all of us joyfully together to be the body of Christ. Listen. Every part of our bodies work. Our fingers work. Our toes work. Our ears work. Our eyes work. Some are, unfortunately don't have their eyesight or have no hearing, but or are able to walk. But can I tell you this morning, there are a lot of people in the Christian world that are still sucking on the milk of God's word instead of eating the fullness of God. And we need to get off the milk and get into the meat. Amen? A carnal Christian never grows up. See, Paul says, you know what? You've been on baby food for years now. This is what Paul's saying. And you're still on baby food. Listen. Look at Hebrews chapter 5. Verses 12 through 14. Listen to what the writer of Hebrews says. In fact, through by this time you ought to be teachers, and you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk is still an infant and is not required with the teachings about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature who have been constant use of having been trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. Everybody in this room should know what's good and what's evil. Amen? See, there's four steps to a spirit-filled life. One, realize your need. 1 Corinthians 13:11 says this. 1 Corinthians 13:11 says this. When I was a child, I talked like a child and I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away childish ways behind me. Amen? Secondly, repent for your ways. Revelations 2:5 says this. Remember the height from which you have fallen. Repent and do the first works. Let me go back. Repent and do the things you did first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. Now, I could go into what the lampstand is, what it is, what it represents in that verse, but I'm not going to. Number three, release your rights. What do you mean, release my rights? Wait a minute. I thought we're free people. We are free. But when it comes to Jesus, we're not free. We're a bondservant to him. We've been bought with a price. Amen. Romans 12:1-2 says this. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, to view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Remember, when we come into the church, we are to sacrifice ourselves to worship God. What do you mean, Pastor? I mean this. doesn't matter how you feel, doesn't matter what kind of day you've gone through, what kind of week you've gone through, you put all of that aside and say, here I am, God. Use me. I lay my life down for you today. You do with me what you want to do with me today. Come on. Verse 2, do not conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and prove that God's will is his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Talk about relinquishing your rights. Do not be conformed any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. How do we renew your mind? By getting into his word, by getting into his presence day after day after day after day after day. You can't continue to think carnally and act carnally and still expect to go into the presence of God. It ain't going to work. Number 4, receive the power of God. Acts 1:8 says this, for you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So you had to, number 4, you had to relinquish your power. Number 3, you had to release your rights. And number 2, repent your ways. And number 1, realize your need. If I can get some music. I heard a story. Listen to this. Some of you may relate to this. But I heard this story and I thought it was pretty neat. It's a story of a man who was on the U.S. battleship West Virginia on the evening of December 6, 1941. They'd been out on maneuvers in the Pacific that week, and on that Saturday night, as they pulled into Pearl Harbor, everyone was given shore leave. Most of the soldiers went into Honolulu for several activities, but this man considered himself a Christian with higher standards, so he accompanied a small group to a church near the base where the Bible study was being conducted. Inside the church basement, the group of perhaps a dozen sat in a circle. The leader said, "Tell us your favorite Bible verse, and let's start here." And they all went around the room, and the guy panicked, and he could not think of a single verse. Luckily, they started on the other side of the circle, and finally he remembered John 3:16 and began to piece it together in his mind. And about that time, he got to it all. It's symbol in his mind. A guy on his left cited that same verse. He was humiliated. He had to admit, "I'm sorry, I don't know any other verse." He went home that evening, and it was just he was spiritually whipped. He said at home that night, thinking, "Some Christian, you are. You don't even know one Bible verse." The man says that at 7:10 that next morning, the sirens on his ship sounded, and he was called to his battle station. It was December 7th, 1941, the day of infamy, when Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. He said, "I looked overhead, and there was smoke all around the harbor, and those Japanese planes were flying over us, and I grabbed my guns. But all we had available was fake ammo. As these planes began to fly over, I'm firing these blanks for 15 minutes. I'm standing on the deck of the ship firing blanks." Then he said, "While I was there, God says, that's exactly the way your life is. Your life was full of blanks. No real power, no real effectiveness. No salt, no light, just blanks. There are real enemy all around you. They're bombing and they're shooting at you. And you have nothing to fight the enemy off. He said later that on that deck of that ship, I said to God, if you'll let me live through this, I'll get out of the baby carnal stage as a Christian. I'm going to grow up spiritually and be spirit-filled. I'm not going to fire blanks anymore. Listen. Thing is, there's a lot of people who can come to church and hide behind the pews, sing the songs, open the Bible, and take good notes, but spiritually, they're not effective. They're firing blanks. They look right, they sound right, but they're not right. I pray today that in the name of Jesus, that all of us would not be firing blanks. Everybody stand. I don't know where your walk is with the Lord. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I don't know where your walk is with the Lord. Maybe you've never started it. Maybe you're one of those natural people. Maybe you're vibrant in your walk with God, and you're close to Him, and you're one of those spiritual people. Or maybe you're just gave your life to Christ some time ago, but you never grew up spiritually. The Spirit doesn't have a complete control over you. You become one of those carnal people. Wherever you may be in your relationship with God, I invite you to come to the altar today. Make a commitment that you would need to make to Him only. Not to me, but to Him only. Make that commitment that you're going to get off the baby food, that you're going to start eating the spiritualness, the fullness of God. Make that commitment. You know what you need to do. I can't tell you what you need to do. All you have to do is just come and kneel at the altar and talk with God. Because He's the only person who can help. He's the only one who can change you. He's the only one that you need. Amen? As they begin to sing, I want you to come. I want you to commit. If you found yourself in any one of those categories, I want you to come and I want you to make a commitment to God. Say, God, I am going to commit to you today that I am no longer going to suck the milk of the Word, but I'm going to eat the meat of the Word. Only you can make that decision. Only you can make that step. I can't make it for you. But I guarantee you one thing. I'm going to be at the altar and I'm going to be praying for myself. That if I'm in that shape, then God changed me. Why, Pastor? Because I'm human just like you are, and I make mistakes just like you make mistakes, and I have to make things right just like you have to make things right. Are you saying that you've done something wrong? I'm not saying that whatsoever. What I'm saying is I'm going to make sure that I am in right standing with God, and I don't have to worry about anything that stands in between me and God, that I know everything's okay. Why do you do that, Pastor? Because I am me, and I know me. So as he begin to sing, I want you to come. I want you to find a place to pray. If you want to pray at your chair, you can pray at your chair. But I want you to pray today. I want you to make that commitment. Say, God, help me to get off the milk and help me get on the meat. Would you do that? Let us pray. Here today, God, that they may just for your information, just to give you guys some insight. Just in a couple of weeks, we'll be having our Harvest Fest on the 21st. We still need people to bring in candy if you can. We would love to have you do that. And also hot dogs, hot dog buns. See Pastor Matt for that. There's a candy basket out there in the foyer. Just bring it in and drop it in. If you don't want to do that, if you just want to give money, you can do that. We can order 1,000 pieces of candy for $45.99, I think it was. If we can get 2 bags, that's $90. So that'll be pretty quick and easy. So if you want to do that, you can do that. It doesn't matter how we get it. We just need to get some candy and some hot dogs in it and stuff like that. We've got water already donated, so we've got about over 500 bottles of water already. So we're going to be doing that. So please do that. Please see us for any information about that. The 15th, due to some scheduling conflicts with the speaker they're trying to get, they've decided to move the pastor appreciation to that following Sunday. Instead of the 15th, it's going to be on the 22nd because of a scheduling conflict. And also that night at 6:30, Cherish is going to be meeting for that night. So 22nd is Pastor Appreciation Day. And Mike, go ahead and sign us off. So you don't want to miss that 22nd for